are your church. We are the home on earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets.
seat. How's everybody doing? Have a good week? Good, good, good. Who's got a praise report you want to share with us? There's something God's done for you and you want to talk about it. Right here. Yes, she did. Praise the Lord for that. Yes, sir. Back in the sound booth. You went to the beach yesterday, and that's a praise report. Yes, it is. All right. Yes, sir. Amen. What's your first name, young man? Philip. Thank you for being here, Philip. We're glad to have you. All right. Anybody else? Good morning. You got new glasses, didn't you? No? Looking at, or you just wearing them? All right. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Are you excited about that? No. Who had a birthday? No birthday? All right. I'm glad you're here. I appreciate your presence this morning. Y'all are a good-looking bunch. You know that? If you're sitting within 6 feet of somebody that just looks really nice today, would you raise your hand? Every husband better have his hand up. You know what I'm saying? Better have that hand up. All right. I am so glad to see you this morning. And we're going to have some more music. And we got baptism this morning. And yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. And then be back tonight at 6 o'clock, and we are in Isaiah chapter 52 tonight. And so I hope you'll come and be a part of that. And then Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we'll be back for Bible study. All right, any prayer requests? We've got a couple of ladies that we need to remember. Annie Meeks, preacher's wife over in Brandon. She's in the hospital with seizures, not COVID, but she got some other issues. And Amy Barker, who does have COVID out in Texas. She is a pastor's or a preacher's wife out there. Pray for these two ladies as well. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Okay. I'll have to remember this question. Yes, sir. Okay. All right. So she's doing. I couldn't get a hold of anybody. So, all right. Well, I'm glad to hear that. Yes. I'm sorry. All right. Good request. Yes. All right. Yes, sir. All right. Yeah, let's pray for this family. Yes, sir. Oh, my goodness. All right. Well, let's remember this request. All right. Anybody else? Right. Yeah. She got to come home. I'm glad to hear that. And a preacher's been here for many, many, many years. About 90 years old. Joe Harper died this past week, and so let's remember that family. They adjust to a new landscape in their family. All right. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. Good to see you this morning, man. All right. Anybody else? All right. Well, we're going to pray. Morning, man. How you doing? And then we've got some more music, and then we're going to study a little bit and talk to you about testing and how we respond. So we're going to look at that this morning in the message. So let's bow for prayer and start our service. Lord, we love you. Thank you for who you are. Many hands have gone up, prayer requests, praise reports. Lord, I would lose track of everybody, but I am glad that you are a God of holiness and majesty and perfection. You hear every request before it's ever spoken. You know the temperature of every human being on this planet. You know everything about everything, and you work all things perfectly for your will. I just bow before you and worship you for that. Bless this service today. May you be honored with everything we do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Yes. Well, I'm glad to see you here this morning. We're going to be in the book of 1 Peter. Let me give you a little backstory of the letter. Every book in the Bible is written on purpose, and there's a reason for it. The book of 1 Peter was written to non-Jewish Christians. These were people that had been saved in the area of Rome. And so the book was written to Christians that lived in Italy. They were Gentiles. They were living in a period of time when a guy named Nero was the ruler of the Roman Empire, basically the ruler of the world. And Nero was mentally unstable. From the years 64 to 67 AD, some persecution broke out in the Roman Empire, specifically against Christians, that was unprecedented in history. And this letter was written to explain to these Roman believers, look, expect this. This is just what happened. It's like when you put alcohol in a cut, you don't have to tell anybody that's old enough to understand. That's going to burn. Y'all remember as kids, y'all remember mercurochrome? Y'all remember that stuff? The spit of Satan. I mean, man, if you had a cut and my mom, go get mercurochrome, and my heart just sank because I knew I was fixing to get lit up. And so if you're a Christian and you live in human culture, can I tell you, it's going to burn you up. All right? You're going to have trouble because you're a Christian. That's going to be the cause of it. The church at this time was about 35 years old, so it wasn't very old at all. And this letter was written after Paul was beheaded. Paul died on June the 19th, 68 AD. And after his death, this letter was written to these people because Paul was no longer ministering. And so Peter writes this letter and is explaining who they are in Christ and just what kind of an impact Christianity has on the world. And in chapter 1, beginning with verse number 3, he just explains what happened to you when you got saved. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." How did you get saved? What did you believe in order to be saved? That Jesus Christ died for your sin account and rose from the grave. All right, that's as simple as the gospel is. And so he says, this is how you were given this living hope because you believe that. Now he's going to tell you what you have. This is an inheritance incorruptible. Now you may inherit some stuff, and then when the IRS gets through with it, you don't have what you had. All your relatives come out of the woodwork. Uncle John, it is so good to see you after 39 years of not seeing you. You know, and everybody now, all of a sudden, is your friend. And your inheritance gets corrupted and it gets eaten away. And so he says, this one is safe. You're safe. If you're saved, you're safe. You have this living hope that has been embedded in you by the Lord Jesus Christ, by your faith in his death, burial, and resurrection. He says, this is reserved in heaven for you. I have no idea what God has in store for us. I really don't. I don't know what heaven looks like. I've never been there. I've never seen an air sample. I've not seen dirt samples. I just don't know what it's like. All I know is that Jesus Christ is there. It is a place of perfection. It is a place of glory and majestic beauty that is almost indescribable. He says, this is kept, and it means guarded, for you by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein you greatly rejoice. I'm glad to be saved. I'd rather be a Christian than anything else in the world. It's for a season, if need be. You're in heaven. This is temporary. We have love bug season in Florida. I hate love bugs. I'm allergic to them. I found that out a number of years ago. The splatter on the windshield. It just does me really bad. And so when I first see them, it's just like, oh, and every May and September, so we're about to come up on love bug season. We get through these issues because we know they're seasonable. It's not going to be here very long, all right? You get a cold, you're not going to have a cold forever. You're going to get over that. So whatever you're going through right now in life, understand this, it's temporary. You'll get over it, all right? Through manifold temptations. The word manifold, y'all know what an exhaust manifold on a car is, don't you? It's got several outlets, all right? It has diversified exhaust outlets. That's what this word means. It means multicolored or diversified. So everybody in here, we've got a good crowd in here this morning, and everybody in here, you got a different color of temptation in your life right now. You have a different, some sort of a diversified problem in your life. Some of you are going through a financial situation right now. Some of you are going through a physical situation. Some of you are going through some sort of an emotional situation. You're going through something, and it none of it is the same color. None of it is exactly the same. It's diversified. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold. The trial is not the precious thing, your faith. Your faith is more precious than gold. Now, gold will perish, though it be tried with fire, that it might be found unto praise and glory and honor and glory at the appearance of Jesus Christ. Now, truth can be tested by the hottest of trials, and it'll come out true. 2 and 2 is 4. You can test that through any kind of mathematical filter, and it'll come out true. 2 and 2 is 4. Right, the Bible is true. It's not just true for this generation. It's always been true. As a matter of fact, the truths of the Bible were true before they were put in the Bible. These are eternal truths. They didn't come into existence the moment the writer was inspired to write them on sheepskin. That was not the beginning of these truths. And so you can examine truth. You can put it through any kind of a test, and if it is true, it will always turn out true. Now, let me tell you the truth about something. If you have been saved, you're no longer who you were. If you have had your nature change, and the scripture uses the word redeemed, if you are redeemed, you get an example. You go into a pawn shop, and let's say last month you pawned a DeWalt drill, 24-volt DeWalt drill. You needed some money, and you pawned it, and you go in 30 days later, and you've got the money, and you're going to redeem that drill. That used to, you know, it used to be yours, but now you lost it, and now you're buying that back. You understand that man has been redeemed. We used to be the sole possession of God before Adam committed sin. Adam sold all of us into sin, so that now all have sinned and all have come short of the glory of God. Well, what did Jesus do? Jesus went to the slave market of sin, and he found us, and he bought us back with the price of his own blood. We have been redeemed from this slave market of sin, and so now you are somebody you have never been before. The scripture refers to it as a new creature or a new creation. Now, the reception of truth, the level of your reception, just simply called faith. All right, let's start walking through this, Anna. We couldn't get it on the pad this morning, but faith is trust in truth. There may be somebody in here, you have a problem with the Bible. Oh, you believe some of the stories, but as far as every principle, every story, every narrative in Scripture, you might have a problem believing some of those things. And I want you to understand, faith is used in two ways in the Bible. Number one, it is used as the body of revealed truth. If you can't get it, don't worry about it. That just simply means a catalog of doctrines. You know, well, a doctrine just simply means teaching. The Bible has many, many teachings in it. And it is, okay, it's starting to work now. Faith is the acceptance of that which cannot be seen or verified except through trust in the veracity of the source. Has anybody ever told you something that you didn't see it, you didn't have it in front of you, but because of the credibility of the person, you believed it? If he says it, it's good as gold. If she says it, it's good as gold. All right, now, God has told us some things about ourselves, for instance, that we are born isolated from Him. We are born in the sin ward. We are born as moral felons. They won't believe that. That then God is telling us what we are by nature. And it really doesn't matter if a person accepts truth or not. You understand that? Somebody might say, I don't believe 2 and 2 is 4. Okay? We're wrong about other things as well. And so we've been told in Scripture what we are and how we can be saved. Now, faith in itself, faith is only as valid as the object into which it is placed. So you can have faith in Buddha, total, absolute, passionate faith in Buddha, and that's misplaced faith. You can have faith that your car is going to make it to California and back without any problem. You can have faith in that. That may not be the case. You may break down in Michigan. And so when God makes a revelatory statement in the Bible about our condition, it is absolutely true. And so faith is used in these two ways. Number one, it is the body of revealed truth, the things that the Bible teaches. Now, the second way that it is used is your acceptance of or your belief in truth. That is the conviction of doctrines. How firmly do you believe the Bible is true? How firmly do you believe that you're separated from God by sin before you're saved? How firmly do you believe that Jesus is coming again? How firmly do you believe that? Or do you just suspect it, or you've heard it before? And that's what we're talking about. Well, let's get down now to verse number 7, where the Bible talks about this matter of our faith being tested like gold. Now, gold is selling right now at $2,035 an ounce, pure gold. Now, it doesn't start out pure gold. It starts out as gold ore. There's a lot of stuff mixed in it. And so you get a guy, and he'll take that gold ore, and he'll put it in a crucible, or he'll put it in a smelting furnace, and he'll melt that, and gold melts at 1,900 degrees Fahrenheit. And so it will melt. And the reason you melt the gold is not to hurt the gold. You're trying to make the gold more pure. And so the impurities in that gold will float to the surface, and they will screen off the impurities, and they will keep doing that until the guy can look into that gold and see his unimpaired reflection. And when he can see that, he knows the gold is pure. Now, here's the illustration. Your faith can be pure or impure. And pure faith is worth much more than impure faith, just like pure gold is worth more than impure gold. How do you purify gold? You put it to heat. How do you purify faith? You put it to heat. 1 Peter, the heat was up. Nero had cranked up this opposition to God's people, and they were in a horrible situation, terrible situation. Through the years, Christians have been slaughtered in some horrible ways. But Nero did some particularly heinous things. He would take the skins, green skins, which was a fresh skin of a freshly killed and skinned animal, and he would sew Christians up in these skins, throw them in the arena, and turn wild dogs loose. And so those dogs would eat those Christians alive. Now, imagine dying like that. This was common, and people would fill the stadium. I've been to the Colosseum in Rome, and it's huge. People, you could just imagine the screams and the people doing the wave and all this kind of stuff. Just people going nuts watching other human beings being eaten alive. And Peter says, now this is not really unusual. Be prepared for this. Now, I want to share with you some things this morning about this matter of testing. And we're in a situation right now in our country where we're being pushed to the limit in a number of ways. But I want to share, God's testing will push you to the borders of your faith. You'll get to the point where, and I've known people that said, look, if this is what being a Christian is, I don't want anything to do with it. And they walked away. They've left church. They've walked off and left their family. They could not handle the pressure. They couldn't. Now, as long as they were standing in the center, as long as everything were, you know, calm and smooth and peaceable and the bills were paid and everybody loved me and really thought I was something else, everything was okay. But when you start getting close to the perimeter, you get pushed to the edge over here and it gets a little uncomfortable, that's when your faith is going to be proven either pure or impure. It is easy, the easiest place in the world to be a Christian is in this building. Right here. Those horrible habits that we do, those things that we say out there, the things that we do out there. And nobody does that here. We'd be embarrassed. We'd be humiliated to do that here. Do you understand that what we do out there reflects what goes on here? Now, let's walk through this. Let's just go to the next one. All right. The truth about trials. Number one, the first thing that Peter's talking about here is this. Trials and testing of your faith. An untried mind will not know what it can overcome. Can you even see that? Okay. It's bigger on my computer. Oh, let's don't worry about it. It's distracting me, so just take it down. Don't worry about it. An untried mind will not know what it can overcome. If you have, everybody's boat floats in the shed. You know what I'm saying? The only time you're going to know if that boat is seaworthy, they're not put it in water. And so you will not know. How much weight can you lift? I don't know. I don't lift weights. Exactly. So you won't know until you lift weights. How fast can you run? I don't know. Don't run. How can you find out? You get involved in that activity. And so you understand that an untried mind, you will never know your limits until you are made to explore the extremities. Now, what does testing do? Testing gets you out of your comfort zone. What do you really believe? See, testing tells you what you really believe. You say, well, as long as things are comfortable, I believe God's a good God and He loves me and da-da-da-da-da-da. But now you get over there, somebody's going to get hurt. You push me over here and you're going to see an animal come out. You know, well, God is God over there just like He's God here. And so testing will show you what you can and cannot do. And so an untried mind will not know what it cannot overcome. Number two, trials show us where we are. I'll give you an example. David and Joseph. Both of them were exposed to the same fire. You remember? David and Joseph were exposed to sexual temptation. Both of them. Two completely different responses. Joseph said, "Woman, get your hands off of me. I'm out of here," and he leaves the room. David says, "Woman, put your hands on me." Same exact temptation. Now, trials will show you what you really believe. If it is a convenient faith, it's not going to take much to get you to collapse. You know what octane is? We talk about octane in gasolines. And you've got what? You got 87 and 89 and 92. They're octanes. And what an octane is, it is the measure of how much compression fuel can take. Diesel doesn't need a spark plug. Well, you can compress diesel fuel to a certain point and it will explode all by itself. Now, a gasoline engine's got to have a spark plug. And so if you have low octane fuel, it doesn't take much pressure to get it to explode. Matter of fact, the lower your octane, the more likely you're going to hear a knock in your engine. You ever heard that? You start it up or start it and it'll have a knock. You got low octane, you're not running high enough octane. What I'm telling you is this. What octane is our faith? What does it take to get you to blow up? How much pressure, how much compression does it take to get you to just absolutely go nuts? and fall into behaviors and habits that are self-destructive, that just absolutely will destroy your family, your health. How much compression can we handle? Now, some folks can't handle much pressure. They can't handle much at all. You know, somebody disagrees with them about a little matter and they just blow up. My word, Facebook. There's some low octane people on Facebook. You know, it just does not take much. Somebody insults them a little bit, or somebody does a little bit of something, and boom, I'm like, oh my word. They don't want their engine to run like that. And so trials show us where we are. The scripture says that if you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is what? Small. All right? If your stitches are loose, and that's what that verse is talking about. If your stitches are loose, it doesn't take much pressure to go ahead and pop those two pieces of material apart. Now, if your stitches are good and tight, and here's my encouragement to you, tighten your stitches. Make sure that your passionate belief of the scripture is absolutely solid. And it is absolutely strong. Number three, trials are not over when the trouble no longer exists, but when their lessons are no longer needed. Seven times in the book of Judges. The book of Judges is the dark ages in the Bible. 350 years, that's how long the book of Judges covers. You step out of the book of Joshua, and it is springtime, and butterflies are floating all over the hillsides of Judea, and it's just a wonderful time of blessing. And then you stoop to get into the book of Judges, and the lights go out. I mean, it just fades to black, and it stinks. And there are seven cycles in the book of Judges about Israel. They would just absolutely abandon the Lord, and the Lord would bring in an oppressor, Egypt, Assyria, Syria, Babylon, somebody would bring them in and compress them. And the Bible says that they would cry unto the Lord, but that's what it took. You know, they wouldn't cry unto the Lord at any other time, but when they got compressed, now all of a sudden God became an important factor of their life. And so they'd cry to the Lord, Lord, we've sinned, forgive us, and da-da-da. So the Lord would raise up a deliverer, and they were called judges. That's why the book is called the Book of Judges. It didn't have anything to do with like Supreme Court judges. These were military deliverers. So the Lord would bring in somebody, take the oppressors, throw them out, restore them to a place of blessing again. And guess what would happen in a few years? They start stepping away, worshiping false gods, murdering their children, and the Lord would put them under compression. Seven times in the book of Judges that happened. When would the Lord send in the deliverer, by the way? When they'd learned their lesson. When will the Lord send your deliverer? When we learn our lesson. Now understand this. You can live life any way you want to, but you are absolutely powerless to control the consequences of those decisions. See, you can let the dog out of the cage, but you can't control who he bites. And so in this matter, trials, they're not, God is not capricious. He doesn't say, well, let's say today I'm going to cause some misery to somebody. You know, that's what I do. I'm God. Let's see. Oh, there was a guy down there in Hardy County. Y'all watch this. I'm going to push his butt. God doesn't do that. All of this stuff is just simply the response of my relationship with the Lord. And so if I want this to be released for me, then I need to find the area of my life that is in direct violation of God's word. If I can deal with that, and if I deal with that, and I confess that as a violation of God's purpose for my life, the lesson then becomes learned. Number four, trials are only big in comparison to us. You're going through something right now that looks like Godzilla. I may be going through stuff that would be a vacation for you. You understand Well, give you a biblical example. You remember when the disciples were on the boat in the Sea of Galilee, freshwater lake, and a hurricane just flipped up all of a sudden, and the boat was about to go down. They were scared to death. What was the Lord doing? You remember? Oh, taking a nap down in the hold. One of the disciples come busting down the stairs and said, "Get up, man. Don't you care? We're about to drown here, and you're down here taking a nap." They thought the storm was in control. And you know, in reality, it was. But the only thing the storm was in control of was them. What did Jesus do? Steps up on deck. Wind is screaming and howling, and his hair is blowing all over the place like everybody else's. And the Lord just simply says, hey, stop it. Sit down. Or something like that. And the wind just says, erk. And the waves are like, shh, shh, shh. Everybody sit down, the master has spoken. And like puppies sitting at the feet of their master, the just becomes mirror smooth. Was not in control of him. I want you to understand, it doesn't matter how high your waves are or how strong the wind is, compared to the God who saved you, it is nothing. So I can look there or I can look here. My perspective is going to determine how I respond to all of this stuff in life. If I keep my eye on storms and difficulties and tragedies and losses and what's going on in the country and the evening news, if that's what I'm looking at, that is going to absolutely destroy my emotional stability. Keep your eye on the Lord. Number 5, trials are the natural consequence of living. You're going to go through them. Don't say if you ever. Here are the situations that are in this building right now. Number 1, you've either just come out of one, you're in one, or you're about to have one. Those are the 3 situations that you're in. Don't get mad at God. We're the ones that turn this monster loose. We turn sin loose in the world. This is our fault. Adam did it in the Garden of Eden. The 2 kinds of evil that got turned loose in the world in the Garden of Eden. Number 1, there was moral evil, which produced physical evil. Moral evil is the thing that Adam did to violate God's purpose for his life. What did God do as a result? He cursed Adam, remember? He cursed Eve, and he cursed Satan, and the physical world fell under that curse as well. Up to that point, everything that Adam ate volunteered. He didn't have to plant corn and cucumbers and yellow crookneck squash. That stuff just grew. Now, he's going to have to deal with sand spurs and dog fennels and nut grass. And those things are going to fight for water. They're going to fight for space, and they're going to fight for nutrition against the stuff that he could eat. And so now there was a battle going on. That's the natural evil. And then after a while, you got your earthquakes, and then you've got your mudslides, and you got your fires. You've got all the natural things that go on in this world. God tried to prevent that from ever happening in the world, but we wouldn't have anything to do with it. We wanted our own way. We got our own way. So as a result of that, we've got this natural evil that has been turned loose in the world. And so trials, just a natural part of life. Have you noticed that? Doesn't matter what you do. You get up, go to work in the morning, you got a flat tire. Just something, you get up one morning, you come home from vacation, and your power went off, and your freezer burned out. You know, throw all your meat away. Trials are everywhere. All right. Number 6, we've got to hurry. Trials are traps to the weak, but they're trails to the overcomer. Weakness and strength are relative terms. If a 3-year-old picks up a 5-pound weight, is that pretty good? That's pretty good. I'd say, wow, You know, he picked that up and curled that thing. Now you get a 26-year-old bodybuilder and he picks up that same five-pound weight, and you're like, ooh, that's pretty good. I'm like, dude, really? You got 19-inch arms curling five-pound weights? I don't think so. I'm not impressed with that. Now, for three, you understand? So weakness and strength are relative terms. They exist only when compared to circumstances that reveal their extremities. And we've got folks in here, you've been through the crucible. You may be in it right now. I mean, it's boiling your gold. Your faith is being tested. Maybe by a neighbor. Maybe by a family member. Maybe by your health. I don't know. Maybe by your job, your boss, people on the job. You're in the crucible today, right now, and you're dreading the sun coming up tomorrow because you got to go right back in it. Well, let that boil the impurities out of you. Don't run from the heat of this, because if you do, you take your impurities with you. So let the Lord do the thing that purifies your faith. And how is faith purified? Well, according to 1 Peter, the same way gold is purified. How is gold purified? 1900 degrees. That's a little above room temperature, folks. So if you want, you understand that faith is going to be tried. It's going to be tried by, well, what are some things? Well, failure, loss, diminishment, sickness, difficulties. So that's how God, the temperature is turned up in our lives. Number seven, trials are custom fit to groom our character. In the book of James, Scripture talks about this matter of trials and temptation. And the word temptation means to encourage to do evil. It means to sick somebody on something that's wrong, to encourage them to do the wrong thing. And the Bible says that God never encourages you to do the wrong thing. I've heard people say before, well, y'all remember the son of Sam Killer? Some of you got some age on you. Remember up in New York several years ago, the son of Sam Killer? He killed a bunch of people, just shot them. I mean, they'd be sitting in a car on the side of the road, and boom, boom, he'd go up and shoot them for nothing. He finally got caught, and here was his confession. The Lord told me to do that. No, he did not. You lying killer, you. He did not tell you to do any such thing. God will never lead you to do that which violates his word. He will never encourage you to do the wrong thing, never. Say, well, why am I always encouraged to do the wrong thing? That's a real good question right there. Exactly. You understand that my lack of faith creates a weakness in my fence. And where are cows always going to get out, Jamie? Where the wire's busted. So I've got to make sure that on a daily basis, I'm walking my fence line. And I'm making sure that my wire's tight and that the borders of my faith are strong. And I do that. You can't come here and keep your borders protected all the time. So we meet here once a week. Well, three times a week, actually, on Sunday morning. And so you can't just come here. I can't be strong for you, and you can't be strong for me. So I can't eat for you. If we went to Manny's and I ordered a ribeye, and you didn't order anything, I couldn't eat that steak for you. I would, you understand? I would blame it on that. Man, ain't this good? Doesn't this taste good? I'd eat the whole thing. You've got to eat for yourself. See, you've got to be strong for you. You've got to study for you. You've got to get on your knees for you. You've got to worship God for you. You have to praise the Lord for you. You cannot expect your church to do that for you. Number eight, trials cause us to explore where we've never been. The Lord will take you into places you didn't think you could survive. Most of us have no idea how much pressure we could live under. Most of us don't know what our octane is. Most we give up too quick. Boom, this blows up. Least little. You ever seen people like that? Just the least little thing. It doesn't take much, and there's a mushroom cloud over their head. Boom. And I think about some of our ancestors in the faith. I've read stories about Savonarola, For 1,500 years, we refer to these as the Dark Ages. For 1,500 years, Christians were slaughtered like animals on a regular basis. And some of the ways they were killed are unspeakable. Pregnant women were stripped of their clothes. Their legs were tied apart with stakes. And a sharpened pole was run up through the middle of them. Their babies were cut out and thrown in the dirt in front of their husbands. They were dipped in asphalt, what we would call, what the Bible calls pitch. They were stuck on sharpened poles and lit on fire. And Nero walked in his gardens in Rome by the light of Christians. We've always been the illuminated ones in this world, you know, but not quite in that way. We don't know anything about suffering. We don't. I don't. I've been in ministry 50 years. I've never suffered. I had a door slammed in my face one time. I'm almost embarrassed to tell you that. You know, my dad was burned at the stake and wild dogs ate my... Well, I had a door shut in my face and it happened right here in Wauchula. Folks, that's my scar. We don't have any scars for Christ, and thank God for that, to be honest with you. I think that's going to come to an end. But I'm just telling you, trials will push you where you've never been. And we won't like it, because we don't like to be pushed anywhere. But God will take you into places, and you will say, you know, I didn't know I could survive this. He said, well, how does he do that? One word. Grace. I don't know how this works. All I know is that grace is the dynamic life of Christ in me that gives me the desire and the ability to live in harmony with God and His Word. I do know that. And I do know that when a tragedy hits your life that you think would just absolutely destroy you, something happens to the believer. Grace rushes in. Grace is like an ambulance that shows up at the scene of the emergency. If it ain't your emergency, it won't show up. Now, we're saved by grace, understand that. But there's a thing that happens to a believer. I remember when my mother died in 1977. I thought that would be the end of my world, because we had 10 days to wait for it. She was sick in a coma for 10 days and finally died. But you know, something incredible happened. There was a sense of, I don't know, what do you call it? Peace. Serenity. Did I miss her? Yes. Did I look at her clothes in the closet and wish she was still in them? Yes. I'd drive by Reese Cliffs there on South Florida Avenue and Dixieland in Lakeland. You know what I'm talking about? That was her favorite restaurant. I'd go by there even today, now that the hurt has been gone for decades. You understand that? You say, I couldn't live through that. Grace will get you through that. Now, you can resist the grace of God and say, no, I got this, I'm going to handle it with anger or bitterness. You can do that, and God bless you. Or you can say, Lord, would you just give me grace to get through this? There's one other thing. The stones over which we stumble often hide great treasure. The things that you think are going to just destroy your life may be the greatest blessing that you've ever experienced. The hardest times. Have you learned through life that you don't learn much in the good times? You kind of put your brain in neutral and coast through those times, and you enjoy it, but boy, when the mud really gets thick and deep, that's when you learn. Either God's God or He's not. Either God's telling us the truth or He's lying through His divine teeth. Either the Bible is true or it is a collection of ridiculously contrived myths. It's true. God is who He says He is. And if you're here this morning, you've either just come out of one or you're in one or you're about to go in one. Keep in mind that regardless of the temperature, there's a God that is caring for you. You remember in the book of Daniel, there were three young men that were thrown into the brick kiln. And they cranked it up went to the thermostat, you know, cranked it up 7 times, hotter than it had ever been, and threw these young men in. They were tied, had the hands tied, and the king was standing on the balcony watching. He was looking down in there watching it, and they were supposed to just burn up to a crisp. And as he looked, 1, 2, 3, 4. We just put in 3, and you know the story. It was, the Lord was in there with those guys. So they get them out. 3 of them come out. They didn't smell. Rodney didn't smell like they had smoke on them. You've been around somebody that's been around a fire, you know it. You know, and their hair wasn't singed. The first thing to get singed, it was going to be your hair, your eyebrows, your eyelashes. Something's going to get burned up and you get close to a fire. The only thing that was burned up on those 3 boys was that which bound them. Their ropes had been burned off. Do you understand the significance of that? What is the purpose of fire? The purpose of fire in our lives is to burn that which binds us. It's to burn that which ties you up, which chains you down. Don't run from that. Don't say, Lord, no, please, another way. There's got to be, give me the key and I'll get it off. Lord says, no, that won't help your faith. What will help your faith if I turn the heat up, burn the impurities out of you? Where are you today? Are you in one right now? Is the heat up? And we know what heat is in Florida. You get up in the morning, it's hot as armpit as soon as you walk outside. You just start melting, your fat starts melting. And it'll be that way all night long. If you're not saved, you need to get saved today. This is not philosophy. This is not religious voodoo. This is a relationship between you and Jesus Christ that must be established by faith in His death, burial, and resurrection. You need to surrender your goals, your mind, everything that you are. Surrender that to the Lord. I'm just saying, just hide in the Lord. Maybe you need to follow the Lord in baptism. Maybe you need to join this church in a way that we can scripturally receive you. I don't know. Maybe you're just being crushed and you need somebody to pray with you, spend some time with you. We'll have somebody with a Bible. Show you what you need to do. Would you bow your heads, please? Every head bowed. If you're here right now and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, I'm begging you. Just get up right where you are and come down here and we'll have somebody with a Bible show you what you need to do to be saved. It's really easy. There's nothing to do. It's already been done. It has already been done. Whatever your need is, would you come right now? Lord Jesus, I bow to thank you for your goodness. I want to thank you for walking with us in this fire. You don't just turn us loose. You're with us. You protect us. You grace our hearts and our minds. And my prayer is that right now during this invitation, whatever decisions need to be made will be made publicly. That people will make a stand and will commit themselves to you right now. I'm asking this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. You need to come this morning. Would you come right now? I'm going to give you just another minute. Okay.
faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. By the authority of the Riverview Heights Baptist Church, I baptize you, my sister, my friend, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. Thank y'all for being here today. Go home, grab you some lunch and a nap, and watch an episode of Gunsmoke or something that's on INSP, and then come back tonight at 6 o'clock. We're in Isaiah chapter 52. So let's stand and be dismissed. Oh, there it is right there. Aaron, would you dismiss us, please? Thank you for being here. Yes, sir.
Skylines and crowded streets calling my attention. The limelight and empty dreams craving my affections. But there is a perfect voice waiting above the noise. Jesus, my only choice when all the lights are screaming. Find the clarity.